decorations going up, people are running around buying their Christmas gifts and their Christmas presents. And we're running around here at Hope Baptist Church like headless chickens, trying to get all the services and everything prepared for what is to come. I love Christmas time. I don't know what we said at Easter time, but I do feel when it comes to things like sermon prep at this time of year and at times of the year like Easter, I do feel a little bit of extra pressure. Because the thing is, we go over the same text every single year. It's exactly the same text that we look at each time we get to this point in the calendar. And the thing is, if what we were looking at was just a book, we could quite easily look at the text that we're looking at again this year. I think, well, I've heard this one before. I've done this, we did this last year. Is there nothing new that we should be looking at? But the good news this morning is that the Bible is so much more than a book. You see, if it was simply just a book, we would read it once, maybe twice if we really liked it, and then we'd put it to one side and say, no, it's got nothing else to say to me now. It's got nothing else to teach me. I'm done with that. I don't need to worry about that anymore. But actually, God's Word is living and active. So we get the privilege of being able to read the same text over and over and over again. And each time we read it, God highlights new truth to us. And God highlights a different meaning from the passage to us to speak into our lives directly where we are for the time that He wants to speak. The Bible, God's Word, is living and active. So as we go through these scriptures again over the course of the coming weeks and the coming month, I want to encourage you to look at this with fresh eyes again today. Ask the Lord, what is it you are saying to me now in this season? My prayer for each and every one of us is that we get a fresh revelation and a fresh insight into what God is doing. And as we begin to open up this Christmas season today, I want us to look together this morning at just how God calls us. And I want to begin by asking you the question this morning. Do you know the calling that God has on your life? Because if you are here in this place today and you are a Christian, God has a calling on your life. He has plans and He has purposes for you and every single one of us. There are things that God ordained at the beginning of time, before the beginning of time, for you to do and for you to accomplish in your life. In fact, Paul says in the book of Ephesians, Ephesians 2, verse 10, we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus, so we can do good things that He planned for us long ago. You, this morning, are God's masterpiece. And He has planned good works for you. Now those good works, they look different for each and every one of us. Some people in this room today, God might be eventually calling you to go and to lead a church. Some in this room, God might be calling you to be a missionary overseas. For some in this room, God has put you in a specific job, in a specific work environment, in order to be His witness where He has put you. For some, God is calling you to vocations like nursing or teaching or other things. God has a calling on each and every one of our lives. And you know what? There is no retirement age in the kingdom of God. Doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are, God has a calling on your life. And the question this morning is, do you know what it is that God is calling you to? This morning we have just heard a text about a girl who was called. A teenage girl, no more than 13 or 14 years old. And she is called to the single greatest task that any Israelite could ever be called to. She is called to the position of carrying the Saviour of the world. The one who was promised long ago. The one who God said would come and defeat sin and defeat death. The one who ultimately enabled us to have a relationship with God again. She was called. And what I find amazing about this calling this woman has is her reaction. You see, when she is called, what we see from Scripture is that she was troubled and disturbed. Have you ever felt like that one? Have you ever felt in a position where God is calling you to something, but God has given you a vision or a dream in your heart, and you think to yourself, no, I can't. No. God, that's far too big. That's far too beyond my pay scale. That's far too beyond any talents that I have or any giftings that I have. God, if that's really you speaking, I want to tell you something this morning. You have got the wrong person. That's where Mary was. Mary, this 13-year-old girl who'd been given the greatest calling that any Israelite woman could ever possibly get. She can't fathom what she's been called to. But she's been called. She may have been frightened. She may have been confused and disturbed. But what we see is, in a remarkable way, this teenage girl's response to God's calling. And because of her response at this particular time, in this particular moment, it leads to the most awesome blessings. You see, God has a calling on each and every one of our life. And maybe those callings do seem far too big. Maybe they seem unreachable to us when we look at it through our human eyes. Maybe they do lead us at times thinking, God, you've got the wrong person. Can't you just use someone else? But I want to tell you today that God wants to work in your life where you are with what you've got. He is an awesome, awesome God and will use you for his glory if we learn to respond to him in the way that he calls us to. So what do we learn this morning about the response of Mary on this particular time, at this particular occasion, for the calling that she has? Number one, I want to suggest this morning that Mary responded to God with a heart of humility. We heard a lot about humility last week as George Bacon was here and he was preaching on humility in our 40 days of community series. You see, when God calls you to a task, when God calls me to a task, it always starts with the posture of the heart. It can be very easy, I believe, at times, to have this kind of romantic notion about God's calling on our lives. We dream up this kind of scenario that we feel that God is going to lay a calling on us, to call us to do something, to call us to a task. And when we choose to step into that task, it's going to be easy. And we're going to walk in the favour of God, and the blessings of God, and everything is going to be amazing. People are going to look at us and say, wow, look at how that person's called. If only I was called like that. The thing is, Mary was called. But think about her calling for a second. Yes, this is the single greatest blessing that any Israelite woman could ever have been called to. But think about what it entailed for Mary for a second. The calling that Mary had on her life basically meant she was going to be accused of adultery because the biological father of her baby wasn't the man that she was engaged to. Because of the calling that this woman has on her life, she was going to have to travel miles and miles and miles in the most uncomfortable of circumstances whilst heaven traveled. Because of the calling that this woman had on her life, she was going to become a refugee. Because they wanted to murder her baby, so she had to flee to Egypt. Because of the calling that this woman had on her life, it meant the one day, she would watch her beloved son beaten, mocked, spat on, led away, stripped naked, nailed to the cross. This was a high calling, but it was a hard calling. The calling of God that he placed on my life is not always the romantic, yes, I'm going to walk into it, people are going to become Christians just by looking at me. And you know, that's why a lot of ministers, I believe, end up dropping out of ministry. Because we have this romantic notion that when we walk in the presence of God, everything is going to be brilliant. But that's not the case. God calls us to tasks which are beyond us, which are unreachable for us, that we cannot simply do on our own. And what Mary teaches us this morning is that whatever the calling God has upon your life, whatever it is he's asking you to do, it requires a heart of humility. Too often, we view God as our servant. And like I said a few weeks ago, if you don't believe me, take a look at your prayer life at times and look at the heart of your prayers and what they focus on. And because sometimes we have this tendency to view God as our servant, when God calls us to a task which is seemingly beyond us, our response can be almost, God, do you know who I am? God, do you know how these plans are going to mess things up for me right now? Do you know what you're asking me to do? You can't seriously be doing that, can you? Whereas the response of Mary was, God, no matter what you want for my life, I'll do it. You see, a heart that responds to God like that is a heart which is cultivated over time. We see from Scripture that those who respond in such a way have their heart cultivated by God before the call comes. Take David, for instance. David was probably the most amazing king that Israel ever had. He was a man the Bible describes as a man after God's own heart. But yet, when he received the call of God to become the king of Israel, he didn't end up in the palace straight away as king. Actually, his heart was cultivated over the years. Before he ended up as king, he was on a hill, tending sheep. But I don't know for certain, but I would hazard a guess that was probably where he first came to words. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. The heart of the matter is simply this. If we want to be a people who respond when God speaks to us, we need to see ourselves as his servant before he speaks. And then, as Mary was able to do, we then too are able to say, God, whatever it is you call me to, I'll do it. No matter what. So let me ask you today, how is your heart right now? Maybe you are here and you're excited about life and the way God is talking to you and the way God is leading you. You find yourself in a similar position to Mary right now. You're saying, God, I don't really understand what you're calling me to, but I'm excited and I'm going to do it. I want to step into everything you have for me. Praise God. Keep seeking. Keep going after him. You won't understand his plans all the time. You won't know what God is calling you to. But when we take a step in the Holy Spirit, he leads us and he guides us. But maybe you're here today and your heart is not really inclined towards him. Maybe you're here today and your heart has grown hard. Circumstances have knocked you. Maybe people have hurt you. And you're really saying, oh, I don't even know if I can continue on this path any longer. The call of God is not as Mary found out. But you are not alone. That's where the church comes in. That's what we've been talking about over the course of the last few weeks together. We need each other. We can't walk this journey alone. What else can we learn from Mary's response? Number two. Mary actively embraced God's plan. Notice when Mary is visited by the angel who tells her, hey, listen, you're going to conceive. Her response is simply, but how can this happen? I'm still a virgin. Just think about this for a minute. Just think about what is going on in this particular room. We can sit here and we can open up the Bible. What we have is the complete account of Scripture in front of us. We can read this story where the angel visits Mary. We can turn over the page and we can see what is coming next. And yet, it still doesn't make sense to us. We still can't get our heads around and fathom how God uses this virgin to give birth to the saving of the world. It is simply absurd to our human minds. But think about it. Mary didn't have that privilege. Mary, at this point in her life, could not turn over the page and say, oh, I can see what's going to happen here. It's all going to be all right. It's going to be hard for a while, but God's going to work it out. When Mary is hearing this voice from the angel, she's in the middle of the story. She can't fathom what is going on. Nothing would have made sense to her. Have you ever been there, I wonder, where God calls you into a situation or to something which just doesn't seem natural and doesn't make any sense? And you're left asking the question, Lord, but why this? Why now? Notice in this passage, Mary, according to the passage, is disturbed and she is confused. But nowhere in the passage does it say Mary wants to change the plan. She cannot understand what is going on, but she doesn't raise objections to where God is leading her to and why he is leading her this way. Instead, she sees herself as that servant and she actively embraces the impossible. And her response in this moment was a response of praise. Even in the midst of not understanding what was going on, God said it, I trust him, let him have his way. You see, what Mary does at this point in the account is she anticipates the fulfillment of God's goodness. You may be here today, you may be feeling that God has been nudging you and prodding you and calling you to a situation you just don't simply understand. You may be here today, and you may be in the middle of a situation you just simply cannot fathom and don't understand why God is calling you to well. But here is what you do know today. The God that we serve is love. The God that we serve is goodness. In fact, the God that we serve promises to work out all things for good for those who love him and are called according to his purposes. That's what Mary's response indicates when she says, I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said come true. And then the angel leaves her. The heart of a godly person ultimately says, I don't have to understand everything about God and what he is calling me to right now, but I'm willing to walk in obedience anyway. You know, if you wait to understand fully the purposes that God has for your life before you act on them, you'll end up seeing very little of the blessings of God that he has for your life. Because if we wait until we have things fully figured out and sorted before we're willing to respond, we end up missing out what God wants to do and how he wants to achieve the miraculous in our life. You know, there's another account of an amazing woman in Scripture, a woman called Esther. I'm sure you know the story of Esther. If you don't, you can read about it in the book of Esther for yourself when you get home. But at the time of Esther, the Jews were on the verge of annihilation. And God raises up this woman, Esther, to the courts of the king, to a position of prominence where she can speak into the situation and see things turn around. But here's the thing, her calling could have meant death. By stepping into the presence of the king to say we need to sort this situation out, she was risking her very life. And when she was mulling this over, a challenge was brought to her. If you stay silent at this time, God will still achieve his purposes. They'll still be worked out, they'll still be accomplished, but you will miss out on the blessing. But who knows whether you are called to the kingdom for such a time as this. You may not know or understand what it is that God is calling you to. But that doesn't change the fact that we are called to be a people who take a step of obedience in the way God is leading us to go. The final thing that we learn from Mary's response this morning is that Mary's response to the angel brought about God's blessing. We go down to verse 45. We see these words spoken to Mary by Elizabeth. You are blessed because you believe that the Lord will do what he says. You are blessed. Why? Because you believe that the Lord will do what he says. You know, God's blessings are often tied with the way we choose to respond in a situation. The bigger the challenge, the harder it is to be a people who respond by faith. Because the bigger the challenge, the more we realize we can't do it on our own. Even though a faith response is hard at times, it is vital if we're going to be a people who walk the way God wants us to walk. What is a faith response? It's praising God and believing that he is going to work even when we don't perceive it. God, this task is too big for me, but I thank you that you're going to come through for me. God, I don't know how you're going to resource this ministry, but I thank you that your word tells me that you own the cattle on a thousand hills, and you promise to provide all I need according to your riches in glory. God, I don't know what I'm going to say when I meet this person. I don't know how I'm going to have the courage to invite someone to the Barrow Woodward event next week, but I thank you that your word tells me that you'll never leave me nor forsake me. It's praising God, even when we can't see the outcome. In many respects, the formula this morning is simple. God calls us, we believe, we respond in faith, we're blessed. God calls us, we believe, we respond in faith, we're blessed. God calls us, we believe, we respond in faith, we're blessed. Why are we blessed? Because what we see when we take that step is that even though the task is too big for us, even though the situation seems too daunting for us, even though we cannot fathom how God is going to work, and even though we might be confused and we might be disturbed, when we take that step of faith, you see God is there. God is in the midst. He's always been there. He's never leaving us. He's always got his hand upon our life, and he is always working out things for our good. God calls, we believe, we respond in faith, we're blessed. What is it that God is calling you to right now? What are those things that that God has asked you to do, that you have thought, God, do you know what? This is simply too big for me. What is the step that God is calling you to take today? How is God leading you right now? Will it be hard? Probably. Is the task too big for you? Almost certainly. Will you understand why and what God is calling you to? It's doubtful. But is God good? Will he equip you for the role? Will he go before you and prepare the way? Will he provide all that you need according to his riches and glory? Absolutely. Mary, a young girl, probably no more than 13 years old, was called to the single greatest task that any Israelite woman could ever be called to. She was confused. She was disturbed. She couldn't comprehend it. Yet she was willing to yield her heart and say, I'm the Lord's servant. Let them be said and done. And as a result of her willingness, Jesus Christ was born. And as a result of that, you and I have a way back to an almighty, awesome God. What is it that God is calling you to right now? Maybe you are here and you've been suppressing the voice of God. You know God's been saying something to you over and over again. Maybe there is a task that you just can't seem to shake. But God is calling you. You know it's the voice of God, but it just seems far too big. There's a great song that I love by Hillsong. And the bridge says, Spirit leads me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the water in the presence of my Savior. I'm going to invite the band back up. You know, I believe that in this place today, God is